is Kalehua Krug. He is currently a faculty member in the College of Education at UH Manoa. He is the father of three Olelo Kayapuni kids, who are the folks that actually pule for us. They prayed for us before we began, and they're sitting over there in the corner. And they look like Kalehua. So without further ado, here's Kalehua.
Yeah, mahalo. Ho maka wau, maka olera Hawaii, oi ei, aina kamali I mana ei. He ho ola ona wale no ke ia, me ke aloha I a o kou, ko kou hiki ana mai ki ahi ahi. No ko mea, a ke ia kumohana nui o ka ho ona awa o mea nui iau, mea nui a ka kou. Oi ei, mao wale no ka ho ona awa o e holomo I ka kou la hui. Ale wale no ke kai ulu ka la hui holokoa, me kai pae a ke kai pae. Nolea ki aloha, ke aloha nui iau ko a pau. Yeah, my name is Kalehua Krug. I always gotta start them in Hawaiian, so that all the little kiki back there that go school in Hawaiian, they feel like, oh yeah, Hawaiian first. That's gonna be one main thing tonight. One of my main goals is going mahalo Leona, mahalo for getting everybody started with goals. I was over there thinking, what's my goals? What am I doing here tonight? But I think a lot of the main purpose of what I believe, what I live, and what I'm going to speak about tonight is utilizing our ways, our histories, our stories, our beliefs as the foundation for everything that we do. Oka ino oka upapohana, the name of my hai olelo is heha'awina kama olelo. And I'll give you definition about what that is. So my PowerPoint is going to be in Hawaiian. And I'm going to present in English. I'm not going to translate. I'm going to have, for those of you who can access Hawaiian, I'm going to have, this is like the deep, you get the backstage pass over here and get a little bit deeper understanding of what I'm seeing. Because I'm going to kind of cut it short. This is probably about an hour half presentation. I'm going to whip through them. Not everything is pertinent to what we're going to talk about tonight.
So do you have subtitles in English?
No subtitles. Oh, I'll get to that.
Okay.
I'll get to that. So these are some of the questions. This is the first slide I put in. I was asked to give a brief introduction of myself based upon some of these questions, but hopefully, I will come back to them in the end, and hopefully I address this through the presentation. I'm going to start with mōkuauhau. So the first word of the evening, I'll give you a subtitle for that. Mōkuauhau is genealogy. Real loose translation. I'm not a big fan of translation, but mōkuauhau is genealogy. And so for my dissertation, this is actually what I'm doing tonight is tweaking my research, my dissertation study, to kind of fit hopefully my assumption of what the crowd is looking for tonight. So I'm gonna try and shape it to you folks. And if it's not going well, I'm gonna reshape them again while we're going. But my mōkuauhau is important because the first thing that comes out of our stories, the first thing that comes out of the lessons of our kūpuna is that the foundation of everything that we do stems from our mōkuauhau. And my mōkuauhau, this wahine right here is why I think I got invited over here, because fourth road is my ohana jellings. We'll get Mayo up the back, but my tutu, to Irene, our brother David Jellings is resident. Well, he passed away, but his children still have the iron on Fort Road. But they used to live that side too. And their father was over by Zablans, living over there. So that's my connection to Nānākuli. I'm a resident now in Wai'anae with my mom. She's up here, but yeah, we live out above the mall. And a lot of what we do, part of the reason why we live out there has to do with our genealogy and our tie to this place. Because a lot of our lifestyles and our decision making come from who we are. It comes from where we live. It comes from the things that we call regular, ma'amau. And those things are the first things that we learn as kids. What are the things that are ma'amau to us? And of one of the first things that in education we learn, especially in Hawaiian studies now, as we go into college, but primarily the kūpuna would have taught this from when the time of the okolehi, the okole helele'i, which is when no clothes, no malo, the babies run around. And the mo'okuaho was the first thing, that first stage of ho'opa'ana'o or memorization. And those are the things that we do now to reinvigorate and to reestablish our understanding of where we come from and our understanding of the root from which all our decisions are made. And I want to keep talking about decision making because tonight that's kind of what my research was intended for. Hawaiian immersion teachers. It was intended for people who are making decisions on what curriculum that they're going to teach in schools, what the keiki should know. And because it's because it's for my PhD, it had to be real focused on one minute little population. But where I believe that the issues that come out of this type of research have more broad-based effects and impacts on the community, and that's what I'm going to be presenting on tonight. So it's basically about utilizing story and the methods that come from our stories, our traditional stories, as foundations of decision making. Real simple. But I'm going to have to go through because there are some important aspects of being able to make those decisions. It's not just that any old story is a story that we use. It's not just any old genealogy that we use, but it's our particular genealogies. It's the ones that not just come from our families, but come from this place, come from all of our ohana, and all of the ohana that existed here prior to colonization. So the question that I asked, again, was based upon what are Hawaiian stories worth to us? And Hawaiian stories, I'm going to give a definition a little bit later. I'm just going to say mo'olelo. Heka vai vai. So what is it worth? Heka vai vai o na mo'olelo ku auhau I ka poe Hawaii. So what are these stories that hold genealogy in them? What are these stories, these histories, there to do for us today in this time and place? And I'm going to try and tie it into what Leona was presenting on because I think it has relevance. And it may speak to some of the issues that all of us face in our ohana and in our homes. But that's the main question for tonight. And how do we use these stories to impact our families and our communities? This is a quote that comes from Matayo Kekuanaoa. I put it in English because I want everybody to understand that this comes from 1862. This was one of the highest ranking ali'i we had at the time. And he was presenting to the Board of Education as the president, a Hawaiian president of our nation's Board of Education. Just that in itself tells us a lot about who we are and where we come from. But I like to read them because, but when on the contrary, there are no children to intelligently take the place of their fathers, history teaches us that the foreigner, at a time not far distant, will push aside the feeble remnant of such a nation and treating them as an inferior race, crush them out from their birthrights with his unsympathizing policy. And these policies shape education today. So this was kind of his olelo vanana. This was his prophecy of that time to where education was heading. He already saw disparity through education. And this is one of the lessons that come out of this type of research. The next type is this. It points to olelo Hawaii. It points to mo'olelo. And what these here, ike ia kahua kanaka o kipa heva ke aloha ika ilio. What this article talks about is the prioritization of us upon us. So being able to understand that we come from us and to learn that first, that's our foundation, to engage first with Hawaiian things because that's how we understand and that's how we develop our identity to engage with the world. For without it, we jump right into someone else's identity. We jump right into someone else's shoes, someone else's understanding of the world, and we begin to engage like someone else. We don't ever learn to fully engage how we should be engaging from our perspective, our worldview. This second one here that points to Olelo Hawaii is iike ia no ke kanaka no ke kahilahui makana olelo. What this talked about, and really when hit home for me, is that if the olelo disappears, and this is all pertinent to mo'olelo later on, because I believe right here, this is the most impactful slide on my presentation. The lessons the kūpuna taught us in the old newspapers, that they had the foresight to understand what was coming down the pipe. And this one right here says is that our lahui is only recognizable by our olelo, by our language. That over time, they understood that Hawaiians was going to look like me. And not, I mean, realistically. And that we're going to look like this. And the only thing that's left for us to be able to be recognized by each other is the olelo that we speak one to another. And this article was the one that kind of drove me to see the world in a different light. And then finally, that last one, mai ha'alele ko olelo makuahine. That was, I guess, the motivation towards the end to make the decisions that I've made in my life, my ohana has made, to continue through olelo. And this is all relevant to mo'olelo. I'll get to it. Yeah. But these are the lessons that the kūpuna has. And so, I'm not like oversimplifying, but this right here is the kūpuna going like this. And they're being blatant and they're being purposeful with as much intent and clarity as they can through our olelo. This is them saying, ke brada, mai ha'alele I ka olelo. Do not leave the olelo. You know, and this here shows up in this, mo'olelo. And so in the word mo'olelo is built in this succession of olelo. That's the literal translation is mo'o is like a succession, olelo is a spoken word. So it's just a succession of spoken word from one generation to another. But it also talks about looking at what the deeper meaning of this breakdown is. So mo'o, it shows up in many other places, like in mo'oku auhau. That the issue of mo'o, or the issue of succession, is important to us, and this is the flag saying, hey, you gotta pay attention to this word because it shows up in some very important places. So mo'olelo, derived from mo'o and olelo, has this built into it. And there's other words too that give me the clue that mo'olelo is an important word because there's mo'olono and there's mo'oku. And those are ranks of kahuna from the old days. And today, some guys call themselves that. But that mo'olono is the lineages, this lineage, succession of kahuna. So the word mo'o is a very important and impactful word that we can use as a flag or, you know, this beam of light showing us that this is important. For my description of mo'olelo, is that mo'olelo isn't just what it literally translates to. Mo'olelo, story, okay. But it's also research. And this for my research project was very important because I was using mo'olelo to be my literature review. That all these mo'olelo are all the kūpuna, that's how the kūpuna did their clinical trials. That's all their research. All of their knowledge came through all of these stories. Because if the story existed in 1835, it had to go through almost 2,000 years of, you know, longitudinal study. I'm going to use all the Western research. You know, it's a longitudinal study. And all of our research, our kūpuna left for us, is real valid because it took place on a large population for thousands of years. And so the mo'olelo, that's the write-up. That's the report. That if we wanna learn what our kūpuna had, it's all hidden in the mo'olelo. Everything that they put was all hidden in those stories, in their way, and the way that they deciphered it, and the way that they wanted to report it. Not in the way now, you know, us bicultural visionary people look at life. It was their reality, and it's ours now to find the decoder ring and go, okay, this means this, and look at them in a different light. So that's where this is going. Let's see if anything is. No, that's good. So for mo'oku auhau, I was starting to look at mo'olelo, mo'okuauhau, and then I'm going to move on already because we went through that. For kuauhau, kuka'auhau get many different meanings. So in genealogy, and this will relate to story because later on I'm going to call all of our stories mo'olelo kuauhau. And this shows up in Sheldon Dibble's story, his account of our history that came and was used in Lahaina Luna as an instructional text. But he wrote the word mo'okuauhau, and he got his stories and his accounts were anthropological studies of the time that were given to the kūpuna that lived at that time period. So what he wrote was just what they were telling him to write. So mo'olelo kuauhau was what they said. And the kuauhau is important because auhau is like a tax. Man, it's like a levy. And the tax falls on the ali'i from one generation to another. So it's that issue of intergenerational transfer of knowledge. So that the kuauhau would move. And what I see the kuauhau being is knowledge. Is that from one generation to another, what our kūpuna gave was knowledge through olelo. We had our own writing system, a little bit different than them. We never write on paper the same way. But we could communicate through text. We could communicate through symbols. But it was, again, in their own way. That was their kuauhau. That was their knowledge base that was transferred from one generation to another. Unfortunately, when the kuauhau is cut, we have no mo'olelo kuauhau. So that's where trying to go back and find our ways to decipher that, not only to decipher that, but to recognize that they were purposefully, the mo'olelo were purposefully left in the newspaper for us to find them. That was the kūpuna throwing them out there. Okay, I know maybe you're not going to get them now, and maybe you're not going to get them 1, 2, 3 generations, but you got to put them out there so that the future, the mamo, the future generations are going to be able to look back and say, okay, we got to get our olelo back, we got to get our vision back, we got to get our perspective back, and once that happens, the mo'olelo going to open up in a different way. And that's what, from all of this, I'm going to be pointing to. But there's also another impactful way of using the word auhau. The auhau is a iwi, it's a bone inside of our bodies that held up the ka'ai. So not all the bones in the body were used. If you know what a ka'ai is, it's the woven, what the heck, it's like a basket but look like one person. Get oyster shell eyes woven into it and it looks like a person, but it held the bones of our ali'i. And it was put on the heiau to remind the ali'i of that time that somebody was there before him, that this place is older than him and has more mana than him, so he keeps feeding the place like his predecessors fed. And those bones that were chosen were the auhau. Certain parts of the spine, the mandible, parts of the skull, but the part that held it up were the auhau. And it's funny that it says the ku, mo'olelo ku auhau, that these mo'olelo were what held up the auhau. That these mo'olelo were symbolically hidden in the bones, that these ali'i held these stories and our ways, our knowledge, as a way to perpetuate our nation, our lahui. And so I utilize all of those intricate understandings of these real simple throwaway words. Sometimes people say, oh yeah, mamolo kohau, mamam, she's from Molokai. You know, and that's it. That's all the time taken to understand what mo'okuauhau means. But if we start to look deeper at why mo'okuauhau was at the foundation of our society, we understand that we cannot just throw it away like that. We cannot just talk about it like we get them, because we don't get them. I'm not talking here like I get them. I like get them. I like understand better what the kūpuna were thinking. And so it points back to all of this ike kuauhau. That was the levy. That was the tax left for us. And it's our turn to carry them. It's our turn to take the auhau so that thing can coo on top of us, the thing can stand on us. And that's where the foundation of my research came from, because I wanted to better understand what was going on in these stories for a kiki and a kaipuni, because I think everybody only used the teachers only use them as a reading, as a literacy ha'avina. You read the story and go ask a few questions and there you go, close them, put them back on a shelf, kids. But that's not the intention of why they were left. If it was, it wouldn't be as nani. It wouldn't be as hoho. It wouldn't be as deep. It wouldn't come in a package with the precision and the beauty that they come in. And to understand that, going back to the olelo, takes that olelo. I'm gonna move past my get plenty of research methods and stuff like that, but yeah, we're gonna move on. So these are just three stories, and I'm gonna throw in one. I'll throw in an extra story at the end of this. I'm gonna tell some of the just parts of the story so you can kind of understand what I'm talking about. Because as I talk about the story, as I retell parts of the story, please consider its deeper meaning and its deeper relevance to what we do. All of us, because all of us here, when you hear these stories, you're gonna be like, ah, I get them. Because I know in my own ohana, when I read punia, I think of my ohana. When I read punia, I think of decisions I've made. I think of decisions my father, my mother, and my grandparents made. And in punia, the story teach me what I need to do from here on out. And it teaches my children what they can do while reflecting on what I've chosen to do. So in the story of punia, I'm moving on. Okay, so punia, okerenuyaiku, and kalapana. And I chose these, just so you know, I chose these because these are stories used as ha'avina, as curriculum in Hawaiian immersion schools today. And there are translated versions that are in mainstream English medium schools. I want to find the one. There's one here. This is one that as a father was very relevant to me because I was blessed with a son. As in here, Punia and his father, Lei Makani, they were fishermen, and he was a farmer too, but he was real disciplined. He was very spiritual too. When Hina was pregnant with Punia, Lei Makani went to the makaula to ask, what are these signs? Because she was ono for certain foods. What are the signs meaning? And what the makaula told him was that when po'ino, there was a bad omen placed upon him, and the makaula told him, this is what's going to happen to you, but this needs to happen because of something else. So he went through this understanding that this po'ino was coming for him. Never told a soul in a story. All lessons now, never told a soul. But very spiritual, prayed, always was reverent to the akua. And Punia was raised in that way. So because of the meticulous nature of Lei Makani's lava'ia and the way he went mahi'ai, so was Punia. Punia was hardworking. Punia knew how to fish, knew how to dive, he knew how to do all these wonderful things that the story explains to us. And this was where Lei Makani spoke about his son. A'ole oya ilike mena kamali e'ae, kalilo nu yoka mana au ikapa'ani. And when I read that, it locked into me. It's like, oh, Punia wasn't like other children. Where his thoughts were consumed by play. And that taught me, I was like, oh, there's a lesson in there. There's a lesson, not just for a father, but for a teacher, for an educator, for educational outcomes, for classroom expectations, proficiency expectations. I can look at that right there and create a method of evaluating whether or not education is successful in a classroom because our kūpuna say it. This is their way they hid these current and contemporary issues in story. And that one has many different examples. He didn't learn laziness just to lie around the house. So these are all descriptions about what his father was expecting of Punia. And now I have a son, I expect the same of him because the mo'olelo teach us. In Aukelenu Yaiku, let me try find now. Here's a good one. So now we look at stories and we get things like aloha ohana. So how we take care of the things that we value about family. Why do we value family? And these stories here say, nolela ke no ke ni we ya oe ovo ke kai e holome o kou, I make o kou, ko upo e kei kuana, alila e make pu wau. So that lesson right there was, I want to go at you guys. And it just so happened in this story with Aukelenu Eiku, his older brothers, his kaikuana, used to beat him up. They tried to kill him a few times. I mean, they're just ino, real bad, bad people in the way that they cared for the family. But this story always made the youngest, this kaikaina of Aukele, always had him go back and teach, no, I want to go with you guys. They went on a trip and he said, no, I want to go with you guys on your canoe. I'm going to leave dad and mom and I'll go on the canoe with you guys. And this said, the last sentence, And if you guys die, I'll go at you, because if you die, I die. And so that was a heavy statement he made for people that, I don't know if many of us would care for our siblings if they did some, I mean, they didn't try throw him in a cave and roll on rock over the cave so he couldn't get out. But luckily when Mo'o was inside and was his grandmother, and she got him out. But that's the part about genealogy later on that shows up, that there's always somebody from the genealogy there to help him with knowledge and with physical escape. But these are all lessons coming through in story. I go to Kalapana. Oh, here's the Quran. And I'm just pointing, there's other lessons learned in the story, but what Kalapana is he's a small, about a 5-6-year-old boy who just got his malo put on. So it's about around between 5 and 7. But what he has is great intelligence of mind. That he comes from a family of riddlers. And his older uncles went to Kauai to teach Wanali'i, Kalani Ali'iloa, how to do ho'opapa, riddling. And because of this, I want to show the genealogy so you understand that the older brothers went to Kauai and they had the full knowledge of their parents. That there were two girls below these two older brothers. One was Kalawa, one was Halepaki. Halepaki was the muli, was the youngest of that generation, which is Kalapana's mother. She was the only one who did not get the full knowledge, the auhau, this full ike, because her parents passed away after teaching Kalawa. So Kalawa and the two Halepaivi and Halepaniho, that's the two uncles, they had all of the knowledge from the parents. They had everything. And Kalawa, but Halepaki didn't. These two older brothers went to Kauai, and this kind of evil chief, Kalani Ali'iloa of Kauai, set up one place of riddling. And the uku, or the payment, or the pili paha, is like gambling, that if people come over there, they're going to compete. And if you win, I die. And if I win, you die. I'm going to throw you in an imu, and I'm going to use your bones to make me one fence around my pa. So it ended up at Kane Poiki, which was Kalapana's father. It's kind of, he's a little bit careless, real quick temper, and he kept telling Halepaki, I don't like what they're doing over on Kauai, because they're from Big Island, they're from Hawaii, Kalapana. And I don't like what they're doing. I don't really understand how come they're doing the way that they do. They're teaching this evil chief. And so he asked Halepaki and kept asking, was persistent. And Halepaki kept telling him, Noah, can I teach you? Asked her, can I teach me? Teach me. I want to go beat Kalani Ali'iloa. Got to teach those guys a lesson. And he kept going. And Halepaki gave in and taught him what she knew. After the lessons were done, she kept reminding him, I don't know everything, bro. You got to go to Kalawa. I'm going to send you to my sister and you got to go learn everything or you're going to lose. And he's like, no. He went straight, and he was remembered and revered as one of the most fierce competitors, but yet his EV was put on the fence because he couldn't compete. Well, little Kalapana, little boy now. I mean, the picture I see is a small little boy, kindergarten. Grows up and starts asking these real critical questions: Where's my dad? What happened to my dad? What did he do? And this inquiry of this child was part of the lesson. The way the child asked questions, so which taught me as a father, is like, hey, I want my kids to ask questions like that. But what do I have to do to make them ask questions? That's going back to, parent involvement. Here's real good parent involvement in the story. Teaching us is like, hey, ask critical questions. Talk to your kids. Because that's kind of, the dialogue between Halepaki and Kalapana was real heavy. It was deep. And this was a single mother and a son. And so he learned about his father, and he came to the conclusion on his own. He's like, "Hey, I gotta learn from you, because Kane Poiki said if I die, you teach this boy to come and get my bones for me. You gotta take care." And so Halepaki said, "Yeah, but it's not enough." And he with his own mind, he came up with, "I know. After this, I'm gonna go to Auntie, and I'm gonna have Auntie teach me," which is already showing the critical nature of understanding that this boy had and the appreciation the mother had. So there was something in their interactions that for me, I understood that This story existed. I'm going to jump out of the story. This story existed for a very long time, and we can track back Kalani'ali'iloa's reign on Kauai to hundreds of years ago. That this story lasted hundreds of years for a reason. You know, and it wasn't just that there are riddles in the story to teach language because the kūpuna thought, oh, they're going to have olelo Hawaii classes. It wasn't that. It wasn't what their intention was. It was to teach these foundational lessons of how we were to be, why we were to be, what we were to do as parents, as children, what was expected of our culture and of our people, and to also show that we come from some heavy-hitting thinkers. And that's what Kalapana was exemplifying at this time. So it ended up that he went to Kalawa, and luckily, Kalawa learned something new while she lived in Hilo. And he took that new information, and he went and he beat Kalani'ali'iloa, got the bones off of the fence, and came back home straight to Mom, which was a lesson in itself. That he got the bones and he came home. He didn't go over there stay, because the people of Kauai said, hey, you noho ali'i oe mana'i. You become the ali'i. And he's like, nope, that's not what I'm here to do. I grab the bones and I go home. That's my kuleana. Which teaches us also, when we go away, come back. You know, bring the bones back over here. That's another lesson, but I'm not going to go over it tonight. But how I found out, what I started to do was extract what I was thinking. How did I get to those understandings? What are the techniques so other people can look through stories and find meaning? And these are the three. I'm going to go real quickly through them. Kauna. We all know what kauna is, double meaning. Now we hear that in, oh, the mele is beautiful, it's beautiful kauna. Well, kauna is found in thought. Kauna is found in intention. That we can have multiple intentions at the same time. And in this olelo, it shows that wa maka ala ia na mea maloko o na mo olelo nona ke kahi maumana o pālua. So those bits of kauna were what the kūpuna were looking for. That when they saw things like, an example I write up is a lau'ape. That in Aukelenuiaiku, na mo'o tutu, ka mo'o inanea, tells him, hey, go get me one lau'ape. And I always thought, what the heck, why are you going to get one lau'ape? Why not just cut off the ape and say, get me a leaf? Any kind of leaf, just get me one leaf. Well, the more I dug into what the ape meant and what the ape signified, it was more now that this tutu who was going to help Aukele, grabs the lau'ape, which is a protective leaf. It's like one la'i. No, I mean, that's when you read up about it, it was put underneath beds, it was put underneath mats as a way to protect the person that was on the mat, on the bed. So this lau'ape already, the kauna of this lau was that, I'm going to protect you. Right off the bat, you say lau'ape, oh, thanks tutu, you're protecting me, which is the kuleana of the tutu, to protect the keiki, parent involvement. But lau'ape, and then the tutu throws up on this leaf. And in the throw up, there's a message. But you can see the throw up and you go, what the heck? The tutu threw up on the leaf. Well, then I looked into throw up. And throw up, like baby birds, is the food that sustains the punua. So this tutu was over there throwing up on the leaf. But in essence, the kauna of that throw up is mana'ai. And the mana'ai is the chewed food that was given to babies. So she was regurgitating this knowledge, this ike, this protection, to give back to the child. And all of this knowledge that she was sharing with him in this cave during this short amount of time, he actually took on his journey and revived his brothers after they were killed with the kawaiakane. So he became a very famous kupua, very famous person in our stories, in our history, because he listened to his tutu. Era keiki of the holohina tutu. So these are all, again, by looking at the story in that way, I now see it's not just there to make me laugh or to make me make a wonderful movie. It would, but there's also kauna that the movie can't show. You know, we're not reading to the double meaning of Optimus Prime when he's fighting Megatron. But in our mo'olelo, the ki'i that we see in our mind, there's two stories running at the same time. There's two understandings of what's being said, which teaches us how to be. I'm going to actually move on. Not this one. Okay, I'll stop there. But I also wanted to use something for us residents on this side of the island, that Haleakala is on hill right up here. And that's where the sun was captured. Anybody know the story of how the sun was caught? Maui.
Yeah, Maui.
Where Maui from?
Right here, Wai'anae.
Wai'anae. Ulehava. Mm-hmm. Who is his mama?
Hina.
So all of this is pointing that the people that reside here have the knowledge, have the environment, have the same wherewithal, fortitude of the person who caught the sun, which are lessons again teaching us that all Maui did was catch the sun for what reason? Yeah, for take care of his mama. That was what he did. She couldn't dry her kapa, so he had to go catch the sun. All of the intention, even though it's a beautiful story, is a lesson that I can tell my son, hey, brother, you better be able to go catch the sun for your mom. That's the length that children go to take care of the maku or the tutu. So grounding ourselves in the stories of our place show us how to be, how we can function, how we can act, but it also helps us develop our own intelligence. And it's not just a Hawaiian intelligence, but it can be a Wai'anae intelligence, it can be an Ulehava intelligence, can be a Nānākuli intelligence. A way to utilize the stories of the people who resided in that area as a way to understand better who we are and who we can be. That to me is the most important lesson of this. Because ultimately, so we'll keep that up there. But ultimately, what I'm looking for is the spine. I'm looking for the iwi-kua mo'o of the story. I'm looking for what are the salient themes. What are the understandings that we can learn from? And yeah, I'm gonna go here first. So this iwi-kua mo'o here, what I found in these three stories. Wait, did I go over the other ones? Wait, hold on. Kauna? No, so kauna is one. And kalame, I'm gonna go over one fast. So these are the three things that I look for to find that knowledge. Now, pilina mo'olelo is a thing called intercontextuality. No, intertextuality, excuse me. And that's where other stories cross. So if you look like Aukelenuiaiku had namako kaha'i in it. Who is namako kaha'i? That's Pele's sister. That's the one that chased her over here. But there are different there are different relationships that point down to genealogy that show where. Oh, this is important, and I just blur it by him. How are you gonna act? But so the interconnected nature of these stories also pointed to the interconnected nature of family. Man, oh yeah, malo. Oh, I only know puni loko na manaw ikaw pa aniye. Kala maito. But So the interconnected nature of story and the interweaving of genealogy started showing me that these were the stepping stones that these children are using. They're using the knowledge of their mo'okuauhau to get through life. And all three of these boys, their makuakane, their fathers were very important. And which is why I used that, because I was a makuakane. I wanted to figure out what the heck I was doing. And they utilized the knowledge of their fathers and the decisions of their fathers as ways to move on ahead in life. And they actually took those decisions and made that where they started from. So genealogy became the first thing that they started from. Not just as a teaching tool, but as a conceptual understanding of where they were going in life and what they were to do with themselves. And so mo'okuauhau, what that pointed to for me, is looking at stories as our first tool in making decisions, which is how I got to the other slide. Sorry about that, very important. That the stories are pointing to genealogy, and most Hawaiian stories, if you look at them, the first paragraph is, it shows where the place is and who the parents are of the person nonaka mo'olelo, the person of the story. So it shows where the characters come from. And every time, it doesn't say, and these characters are important, because no, you're just saying, here, boom, it's first. The first thing is important. In our olelo, the subject isn't the first thing. You guys who came to my class, you know, the subject not the first thing. The action is the first thing. There are other things more important than us. And that shows up in our grammar. And that's what these stories were teaching us, is that the character wasn't the most important thing. The first thing that shows up is the tutu, the mama, the papa, that without knowing where they came from, that we don't have to know about the thing in the story if we don't know where they come from, because the question always going to ask of the kūpuna, yeah, but where are you from? They're going to always say that. And not just from aina, they're going to say, where are you from? Who are you from? Because that tells a story. Where are you from and who are you from tells a big story. And so that was what led me to look at story as a lesson. And a lesson to deconstruct so that we can use the form of our stories as a way to create curriculum today. Instead of going on, you know, fifthgradelessons.com and looking for lessons that Idaho Ma make, we don't need that. That we have our own forms. We have our own methods. We have our own teaching strategies. We have our own expertise. And they're all found in what? Mo'olelo. Because I'm going to get to how this affects the community and how this... I'll go to another... Leona. I'm another goal of mine is to help the community understand that we possess expertise. We possess... it doesn't show up in degrees. And part of the reason, I'm going to answer one of the questions from before. I'm jumping off topic. But part of the reason for me moving through the ranks of education is to debunk its importance. And not important that we shouldn't go get them, but to let people understand worldwide, globally, that Hawaiians can be Hawaiian, and still achieve the highest levels of education that you throw at me. And not the you versus me, but there is a binary split in culture, there's a binary split in knowledge, there's a binary split in nohona, and I'm a walking example. I freak people out, but this, I only freak people out because of time. In a particular time, this would have been normal, and that's, again, another lesson. It's a walking lesson. And so what these, I'll go back to this now, what the stories are pointing at is that we start from our own foundation. We find our own way of being, we find our own understandings, and that's where we begin. And from that is the foundation to build all of the other knowledge on top. So if a school is gonna teach math, and you jump right to the computer, right to the calculator, right to division, multiplication, in my personal opinion, without looking at our counting system, because I get articles from the newspaper that also beg the children of 1880-something to don't leave the counting system either, that there are specific lessons found in our counting system that Hawaiians counted, we quantified in our own way. And that doesn't take any mana away from the Western method of quantification, and nor does it mean that we don't learn it. What it does is that we start to sequence who we are from young. We teach the kids our own ways, our own olelo, our own mo'olelo, our own lessons, our own ways of being, because that's the solid foundation to build education on. Without that foundation and identity, they adopt other identities. They adopt other people's ways of being, and that is the guiding light for the rest of their life. And that sends our children, our ohana, into penitentiary, into drug abuse, into all of the desperate statistics that we find our people in. And so this is the impact on community of what I was researching, was looking for a way to empower community and to have the community to understand that maybe we don't have the degrees, maybe we don't have, and I don't like this, what this quote-unquote doctors, lawyers, we don't have big populations there, but that's not our way of judging success. That's someone else's measure. That we need to measure ourselves based upon our own measurements and our own expectations. Hard work. That's one thing that comes through all of these stories. It comes through my family, it comes through my wife's family, all of the Hawaiian families that I see, and that's just an example, but that telling that story to my children makes them, that all I gotta do is go, eh. And they know already, okay, and they go. Because that's the foundation. And that they take in school. But it was established prior to entrance. So the parental involvement has to come into sequencing our way of interacting with our children and not jumping. Some people hate me for this, but not always going A, B, C, D, not that. That talk to the keiki first. Don't just say, once the keiki can walk, I'm going to show you this book here. Because that's their way. And I mean there, we can learn all knowledge of the earth. All. We have the capacity to learn it all. But that's not what we start with. We start with Hawaiian interaction. We start with empowering the child in olelo, whatever the olelo is. Because without interacting with them, they don't know who we are. They don't know who our makua are, our kūpuna. And without that, like some of the article in the newspaper, they don't understand themselves. And when they don't understand themselves, they're going to adopt someone else's way. And like you said, the TV teaches us one way. And if the TV is the babysitter, so to me, and I think this type of interaction, this type of mo'olelo, because mo'olelo also has another definition, and it's the art of telling stories. And so for a father to sit with the children and make a decision to tell a story with a Heineken or without a Heineken, it's a heavy decision for the impact on the identity of that child. You know, to roll one joint and put them on the table and then tell a story, that's a huge impact on the child that is sitting there listening to the story, and it says a lot. So if we could, and this is my plug, that's my commercial for Olelo Hawaii, because Olelo Hawaii to me is the key. Without this key, without the decoder ring, I could have never accessed what my ancestors left for me. And these are three stories of hundreds. You think of the potential and the possibilities of understanding better who we are as a whole, that I don't need to listen to Michael Apple or Yuri Bonfrenbrenner or Vygotsky, Piaget. I don't need them because my kūpuna already did that work. They precede Vygotsky. Scaffolding shows up in an article 100 years ago from Joseph Poipoi about how you teach kilohoku, and it goes through steps that show up in psychoanalytical research. And these people get credit for understanding that our kūpuna did. And this was in a 2-page article. It was like the kūpuna thought, that's common sense. And so that to me is what studies like this and future studies that build off of this have to offer the community, because we need to start valuing our own stories. Even if they're negative, if I was Kane Puiki, I wouldn't want Kalapana to know that I was overzealous and got myself put in a imu. I wouldn't want him to know that, but that's not his choice. But that was a choice he made and he learned from it. But without knowing the story, Kalapana couldn't know to go learn from Auntie before you go. And then he won. All his papa had to do was go learn from Auntie, and then he would have won. But he chose not to. And Kalapana used that decision to spring himself forward into the future, and he became a deity. He became famous over hundreds of years of our people's history. Kalehua Krug, they became deities because of how they decided to act in life. And that's, again, to be able to send back to the kids is like, our stories are important. Our lives are stories. Is your story going to be heard for 100 years like this? You know, and that's the intention and that's the motivation for them. It's like, oh, man, okay. You know, maybe I cannot go drink with my friends and then drive home. Maybe I can't, maybe I cannot do these things because what if I cut my mo'okuauhau short? What if I cut my story short? So there's, great impact, many implications on what is the result of this type of research. But I'm going to leave it there and see if anybody get questions. Higino, lava, that's about an hour. Okay. Questions? Nothing? Okay. Well, I still on smoking break. But I get another idea. So between April and May, we're going to start them back up. Has nothing to do with the presentation. But yeah, the Olelo classes, I'm going to start them up in the next few months. And I'm going to be bringing students to help learn how to teach. So it'll start up in the next few months. Well, I'm going to give you, my last name is spelled K-R-U-G. If you want to email me, krug@hawaii.edu. Yep. Oh, it's on the sheet. Oh, they didn't print them. Okay, so on the sheet, I left my email. So if you want me to keep you in mind for the class, I get an email list, then yeah, send that to me. We offer Hawaiian language classes. We've had for about a couple of years now. Taking a little break while I finish my doctoral work, but now it's done. I can start back up again. The last place was at the Princess Kahanu Community Center, I think that's called. Yeah. No pressure. It's just the key to knowing who you are. No. Any questions, though?
Can you repeat the question?
Okay, so Shirin asked me about the significance of the Madauhi. Some of you guys know Keone Nunes.
Yeah.
That was my, I spent about 11, 12 years with him learning to do kakao. So that's kind of what we do. I teach my son kakao. The significance is, yeah, they're plenty different. I mean, all of them have their own name. All of them have their own mo'olelo. And actually learning kakao helped me to better understand what I was reading in story too. That interconnected nature of everything. But between the designs, the plants that show up on our in our art form, animals, the weather patterns, I mean, our whole environment shows up in design. So that's, but I mean, the significance to me is it's a protection. Eh? This is a protection, spiritual protection. The head designs, when my kumu puraman, what he explained to me was that they're like for higher level kuleana. They're for people who take on kuleana to either teach or, you know, to have vision, those type of things, yeah. Mahalo, you guys. Oh, okay.
What's your favorite story?
Oh, all of them. That's almost like, what's your favorite kalo? The one in front of me, that's what Uncle Jerry always says. What's my favorite story is the one I'm reading. Yeah, hard to. Well, I can give you, if you guys read the old stories, the parts that I like the most are the dialogue. So when they talking to each other, because that's also teaching us how they interacted with each other. Because when you get to the point where you can read through the story, the narration part is kind of like, oh, I get it. That's kind of how we talk. But sometimes once it gets into the quotations, oh man, the olelo change, the way that they, their discourse between each other, hoorah. And I'm not sure if that's how that was reminiscent of how they spoke to each other, or because it was coming out of their mouth, they were trying to make it significant, that it's a higher level language coming out of their mouth, and the narration was more a lower level, more understandable. But yeah, that's one of the most interesting parts of mo'olelo for me when I read. Yep. Mm-hmm.
When you say foundation,
yep.
What's another word that's more meaningful that tells it better?
Not
better, but I mean, that people would get it. I mean, I think I know what you mean, like this confidence that can't be stirred. I mean,
I think it's like a worldview. A worldview. I mean, there's plenty of worlds. Worldview, perspective, understanding. The fundamental characteristics of Hawaiian being. I mean, to me, the YSA foundation is because I wrote my paper in Hawaiian. And that's the only word I can think of that kind of comes close to kahua. To me, that the kahua is that's all the niho stones that go inside, you know, they go into the hole. You dig a hole for a post. You know, there's stone in there to hold, and then you fill them with dirt and you fill them with water to cement those poles in. At the foundation, I don't know how to get, I mean, it's kahua to me. That's the better word. Because you understand kahua, your hale gonna fall down if you know more kahua.
Yeah.
And that's what I think happens to our people sometimes. But what I'm not saying is that I don't think as a people we're in bad shape. I actually think we're in good shape, but we're looking at ourselves through someone else's lens. That's what I'm saying. I don't think we're in bad shape. I think we're actually fighting losing our lens, where we're rebelling against, yeah, we're rebelling against what someone else's perspective on the world. Yeah. Yep.
So on, just adding to that, like, even for education, it's hard to, because culture plays a huge impact in learning, that it's like we're trying to fulfill standards,
yep,
but we're not getting the depth of learning.
Well, I'm going to go back and put up ke kua nao'a, because the last word he used, you know, the last word, if I'm not mistaken, was policy. That if you look at unsympathizing policy, that's the truth right now. Oh, kalamai kumu kalehua, you gotta teach this, because No Child Left Behind says this, and our state standards say this, and you're gonna be assessed on this, which pulls us farther and farther and farther away from who we actually are, and what we actually should be teaching our children. Yep. Teach our children to see stories. I let them do it. I mean, that's one thing that my mom always tells me, hey brother, you cannot do it all. You know, even though we try our hardest, but we cannot change everything. In this lifetime, we're not gonna get to it. So we gotta figure out what we gotta leave in this lifetime, like what our kūpuna did. Figure out what we gotta leave now so that the following generations can pick up where we left off. And to me, the first thing is teaching them this, you know, because even I'm gonna go back to even when I look at kalamai, but that part about kauna, looking at or even all of this, but even the kauna, intertextuality, and genealogy of story. That's only three. I'm hoping somebody else will look through it and say, yeah, but kalehua, what about this? And I go with this, yay. Because now we have four. And then look for something else. Then we're gonna have five. That to me is, I'll be honest with you, this is like Hawaiian common sense to me. That after I seen them, I actually was telling myself, can I write about this for my dissertation? But this is kind of simple. I mean, basically, after you get past shedding a lot of our previous methods of understanding, if you get to this point, you always go to this, hello? It's almost like when hello. But getting to the point where it's hello, that's what I hope the kids do, that even now when I talk to them, I don't go through it like this, but I always ask them questions about, hey, bro, what is that? And then all he got to do is go, well, it's this or it could be this. I'm just, oh, thank you, son, so much, you know. Because that's all I think. I look at the generations. In my own opinion, real loose, the generation before me, that was like the alarm clock. Me now, I gotta serve breakfast. That we just starting to awaken ourselves. We're starting to understand the level we can go. That this right here is not even deep. I believe I just went digging to the sand and I was like, eh, get a little bit watery there. But you can dig deep into the sand. And that's gonna take generations. It's not gonna take, you know, weeks, months, few years. And we can keep looking at story and keep looking at this for generations. But the most important thing is that we know it's there, because that empowers all of us. That our kūpuna left all these stories for a purpose, whether or not we know them or not. Right now, no matter to me, because I know where I come from. I know the type of person my ancestors were, and broadly our ancestors were. And I know now I gotta work real hard to match what they did, real hard. Yeah, and that to me is the most important thing to get from this. That, you know, all our keiki's gotta know is like, oh, maybe I cannot be on an iPad all day. You know, maybe I cannot pound reggae music in my car, because all our old songs, that's all stories. I'll often get lessons, not just language lessons, but cultural lessons, ways of being. And so now maybe we gotta put Kahono Lake back in our radio. Yeah. Sorry. I just feel like that, yeah, this impacts every single, I mean, now I question every, I mean, when I get in the car, my hand is like, oh, what button am I gonna press? 98.5, because I like relax, or I gonna go to 940 for the kids, you know? I mean, that's a hard decision at 4:50 in the morning. Sometimes you just turn them off so the kids can sleep. But yeah, but that's where it goes to me, that every step you take, you consider your kūpuna first, where you come from first, every step. Every slight movement. Yeah.
You know, engaging them with these type of learning opportunities.
Okay. Well, I can actually talk to you later. I mean, I think there are places that exist now, people that they can associate with. For me personally, I have my own set of friends that believe in this, and we get together with our sons and our families to do certain things to reinforce these beliefs and these ways of knowing and seeing. But I think, yeah, I think work is being done to make it more broadly available for the younger generation. I mean, we can talk later about that. I know a lot of people. It just depends on what you want from that organization. Yeah. Yep. Part of the requirement is that I need to publish my dissertation, so yes, it will be published. Whether or not it gets picked up by a publishing company, I don't know. I don't know if I'm gonna do that, but I think I'm gonna try to submit this manuscript in Hulili. Hey, KS. Yeah, just got an invitation. Just got my invitation today. I was like, oh my goodness. Yeah. Yeah. Oi, mama. Yeah. So hopefully it'll come out in a short version. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm not apologizing for that. Yeah. It'll come out in English later, but Hawaiian first, gangi. Hawaiian first. Yeah. Hau. Mahalo.